Hi, Mehdi Sundagi, and welcome to Your Finance TV. We're kicking the week off with Brendan McCarthy from Column E Management. Brendan, good to see you, mate. I hope you had a great weekend.
I did. How you doing, Mehdi?
I can't complain. Well, if I did, no one would care anyway, so better not to. So let's have a look at the markets. Last week, the S&P didn't really do that much. It was down about 30 basis points, but we had some decent earnings. There was some biggies out there, some CPI data, PPI data as well. But it does feel like the market's a little bit fatigued at this point. What do we have in store for us this week? I think we've got economic data out of Japan, Q2 GDP tonight, national CPI on Thursday night, China industrial production and retail sales tonight. So there's a bunch of stuff coming out, but you know, on the US front, we've got retail sales Tuesday morning, FOMC on Wednesday, and of course we've got some bellwether earnings coming through, which we'll touch on a couple today. But do you think a lot of this global kind of commentary and stuff coming out of whether it's Japan, China, do you think there's much impact for the US investor at this point?
No, I don't. I think this time of year, it's all about risk is capital protection more than anything. I think people are not really, they have one eye in the news and one eye in their stock prices. Excuse me.
And one eye on the Mai Tai while they're on the beach.
Exactly. And the focus shifts, right? Basically, what you see is stop. A lot of people putting stops out there in positions. They always say that the junior guys are running the desks at this time of year. I don't know if that's still the case when we have a remote world we're living in, but maybe they have a junior guy on the remote somewhere running it. But long story short, the news matters, and sometimes it's not that big a deal. China's of interest though, because China's deflating, and I think China tends to be weak this time of year. Remember last year they had trouble leading into the fall too. Remember that was 2 years ago. But China's news will be of interest to me anyway. Things are deflating over there. The public officials are panicking. The stock indexes have both turned lower. It looked like they're breaking lower. I mean, if you look at the Shanghai comp or you look at the Hang Seng. So that's the bigger news. The FOMC, it's all about Jackson Hole at this time of year. If FOMC minutes come out with a surprise, like right now the market's expecting no more hikes, or maybe one, I don't know. They should be expecting more, but they're not right now. If the minutes were to say, oh, we have 10 hikes coming, I mean, that will surprise people. Otherwise, that's a non-event. The yen's weakness in Japan, kind of interesting. I don't know how it's going to affect their numbers. I've always wondered how the Japanese economy would deal with a falling currency like you see right now with their economic data. I mean, they try to defend their interest rate markets, which they did a good job the last few weeks. So 2 weeks ago, it spiked higher, but they've kind of kept a lid on the 10-year since. But I wonder what effect a like really weakening yen has on an economy that has, what, six times its debt versus GDP. Like typically, a company that sees the stock price going to zero with a high amount of debt, it's called a zombie company. Do we call Japan a zombie country? I don't, tough to say. So those are the big factors, but I don't, unless they're completely a surprise in terms of the news, they'll be ignored. People go back to their Mai Tais and they'll protect capital. I mean, the S&P is weaker, and I think that's just capital protection right now more than anything.
August is always difficult, and we don't share. There's not much volume out there for anyone to really play around in anyway. So, you know, we'll see how it all pans out, but definitely some things to watch on the horizon just from a news flow perspective. As well as news flow, we got a couple of decent, you know, names on the earnings front. Some seen as bellwethers, but you know, we've got Home Depot this week. I believe Tuesday pre-market, they missed revenue expectations on Q1 and lowered their profit and sales outlook for the year. So you know, some of this might be already priced in. But traditionally, last week, Telsey Advisory Group downgraded them. You know, citing housing market weakness and falling home sales and mortgage increases. So, you know, what are your thoughts on Home Depot?
So I don't understand how you say how, like with Telsey's downgrading, this is a side comment that just occurred to me. But with Telsey, she's saying Dana's or her crew was saying that Dana was a Bear Stearns analyst when I was at Bear. So I call her Dana because Anyway, she were always with these black suits on back in the day. You knew with Dana when she walked in the door, she's had an aura. But anyway, her group's downgrading the stock, saying housing weakness, but people tend to go to Home Depot when the housing market's weak because they build up their existing houses. Residential is not weak either. Residential is somewhat strong because there's just not a lot of houses out there and prices are going up. Well, if prices are going up, your home equity is climbing. Aside from that, in terms of Home Depot, I would just say that the stock's in breakout mode that argues against anything the housing market's a problem. Maybe the way I look at the chart is maybe there's one last surge in the offing here. Problem is revenues are still below. I think that you said they downgraded revenues. They are still below a year ago levels, like earnings, but but not rising much. Earnings are rising more quickly though, which argues that margins are improving. So if margins are improving, the stock gets cheaper. That supports the climb. Though I would like to see revenue to rise. Sentiment's pretty poor among retail. They're not really buying it. Hedge funds are also getting out of the name, like a lot of retail. You can see that in the 3Ls generally. Bloggers, though, remain bullish, though moderately so. I get the feeling if there's a surprise in the revenue side, because nobody's really expecting that, because they sandbagged at the beginning of the year. I wonder if there's a turn higher in revenues that will argue that stock gets a surge to the upside. Maybe that's the catalyst. Lumber prices, somebody said lumber prices were a negative. If you look at the chart rallies when lumber prices fall. So that for one helps. That argues like lumber prices are coming off right now. Home Depot's surging. I think it hurt lumber price. It hurt them earlier in the year because they had too much lumber and they don't hedge it. They just rally. It's like gasoline prices. If you have too much gasoline in the tanks when you're selling it and prices are falling, there's nothing you really can do. You have to eat it. Those gas stations have to eat it. So I think that's what Home Depot ran into. Now that we're in a place where lumber is not being is not rare, or it's not a rare item like people are like going to the store and begging for it. I don't think it's a factor as much. I think it's a benefit. I've been running a theory this summer that consumers have generally been traveling less. That's based on gasoline demand. I wonder if they're focusing more on their homes as a result, and if that's the case, they're going to Home Depot or Lowe's to drive revenue. So I wonder if there was a trade-off between vacations and Home Depot. It's kind of a strange little consideration, but Home Depot stock chart right now argues things are getting better and it's surging. So even though sentiment's pretty poor, I think that they may have sandbagged the numbers too low, and the chart may argue the numbers are going to be better.
I will definitely keep an eye on it because, I was in Home Depot the other day and it was definitely not quiet. So,
Parking
we'll see.
lots are heavy at Lowe's. I was completely. You don't usually see a full parking lot at Lowe's. You see all the employees parked like further out, I think. When I was at the grocery store years ago, they always made us park far away so the consumers could park up and close. Well, you can tell where the Home Depot employees park. They park at the end of the parking lot, except it was all full. I say Lowe's. It was Lowe's in this case. Lowe's was completely full, and I've never seen that. And not that I'm standing in front of a Lowe's store on a regular basis to examine this little strat this thought, but it was kind of interesting to see that. I wonder if that's where my thinking is. I wonder if people have just not are not just not traveling because it's expensive, and they're fixing up their homes because remember the pandemic, we all stared at our homes and we wanted to update them. I wonder if the same thing is occurring out now.
Yeah, definitely some food for thought. I certainly felt that in Home Depot last week. So we'll see how it all pans out. Maybe they did sandbag early. So another one that one of my favorite shops, Target, Wednesday pre-market. It's always a fun shopping experience at Target, I find. But their guidance will be a focus again as well for investors. They had their sales and revenue slump around their LGBTQ pride merchandising earlier in the year. So, what are your thoughts on Target?
For Target, I look at the picture and I see a company in decline. The earnings and revenue picture is just dreadful. Management screwed up big time last year. They couldn't handle inflation and theft and all that sort of nonsense. It's not nonsense, but they use that as an excuse to whatever. I think the trade down into Walmart and Amazon is a real thing with Target. I actually saw there's a I happen to be at I haven't been to Target in a while. We do a lot of shopping online with them, but I haven't actually been at a Target. But so their parking lots look relatively empty relative to a year ago, last time I was in there. So again, the parking lot indicator, we'll call it, right? And the analyst community on this one has been got the story wrong. They keep thinking the story is going to be right, and they keep their recommendations seem to be higher than the stock price, and the stock price continues to tumble. So the analysts have been chasing the stock lower with more and more downgrades. I think I see 13 buys out of 28 ratings. So they're getting there where they're starting to believe, all right, maybe we're getting some sort of equilibrium. But the chart looks pretty dreadful. It looks like it wants to go lower. Earnings haven't been good. Analysts are off balance. Retail is not a big buyer. Hedge funds are selling it. Bloggers are the only thing that's bullish, and they're not really particularly bullish. So if there was the ultimate situation where a stock could surprise literally everybody with an update, a better earnings report, it might be Target. I just laid out a plate of negative stuff. The story's pretty bad. It's a show me stock. So the chart's lower. Nobody in their earnings season has been bad for most people. So if Target misses, the stock's gonna get, probably getting a hit. But I wonder if the selling is priced in by literally everybody. Again, we're in Target. So we're in September, so August. So chances are it won't move as much. Well, maybe actually I could get the shorts covering. So risk protection goes the other way. So I would just say that they actually have beaten the last two quarters if I'm looking at the numbers correctly. So they sandbagged the numbers down, but they beat. So they need to not only beat the numbers, but they need to raise the forecast. That will get the stock turning, changing direction. The analysts are at equilibrium. Another leg down is going to cause another wave of downgrades. The first thing I noticed when I saw this stock, the earnings today, was I thought of Bradley's. And they're not Bradley's, but they did buy a lot of Bradley's back in the day when Bradley's went out of business. I wonder if Walmart and Amazon is just killing them. And it's just a thought. Target's also the ones I've been into. So I have been in them last year. They've been dirty. They haven't been focused. The cleanliness is not there anymore. They look like Walmarts. You know, it's a tough, Target's in a tough situation. They're in a bind. They're being tackled by everybody around them. And you can't be this way. You have to be an experience. You said you enjoy going to Targets. Well, they're making it harder.
So it's definitely funny you say that, because there has been a decline in cleanliness. I did notice that. The only reason the experience is kind of still fun is because they kind of have everything. But on the flip side, I did go to Walmart last week, and their car park for your car park sort of, attendance kind of counter, their car park was very full. And it was a much cleaner experience than historical. And it was, again, a really good shopping experience. And if I was put my feet to the fire, I would say the experience at Walmart far surpassed Target, which I don't think would have been the case this time a year or 2 years ago.
You know what's funny about Amazon? When they launched their stores, you walked into an Amazon store and you got a feeling that it was kind of cool. I always liked the Amazon. It just seemed like a really cool experience to walk in Amazon. You had the tech on the right. You had weird things on the left. You had the books in the back. A lot of those Amazon stores are gone. But it's funny that Walmart has moved in the direction of Amazon stores, because Amazon doesn't have stores. They have distribution sites, whereas Walmart has these stores that have become distribution sites. So we'll talk about Walmart in a second, but it's just Target stuck in the middle and they're lagging behind. And they've tried and tried. They need a clean slate. You almost need a washout with the sentiment. You need a clean slate in the stores. They have potential. They got a great grocery. The grocery stores there are a good shopping experience, much more organized than Walmart's. And the prices on goods are selectively better, but they're just in a bad place. If there was a stock that would surprise anybody, it would be this one, because the sentiment is so poor.
So let's have a look at Walmart. You know, Walmart's Thursday pre-market. In May, they'd raised sales and profit outlook for the year. So they kind of saw a boost already, especially on the grocery and e-commerce business. And, you know, what's interesting about Walmart is I feel like historically, they always had the visitors. They just couldn't get their e-commerce side to even fractionally catch up to Amazon. So it feels like that's starting to go in the right direction. Yeah, I know I see some more Walmart boxes coming to the house versus Amazon as well. Don't worry, Amazon is still definitely well represented in our household. Walmart's sneaking into the mix there. So, you know, what are your thoughts on Walmart? I think they've done a good job.
So yeah, if you look at Amazon, sorry, Walmart, and you compare it to Target, they are polar opposite stories from sentiment, earnings, everything. Walmart is going up, Target's going down, and that makes you wonder if Walmart is at risk of a miss. I know the parking lot was really full last time I was there. You go across, you get Walmart's on one side, and then you go to Lonely Dick's Sporting Goods on the other side, and there's nobody in there. But we're not talking about Dick's this week. It's just. It's interesting, like the analyst community is still chasing this one. So the analyst community doesn't buy the positive story, but literally everybody else does. Bloggers, retail, they're all buying it. I know the analysts have 23 out of 27 buys on this name. So that's bullish in itself, but they still have four holds out there. So there's still upside and they're still chasing. The stock's in a breakout mode to the upside, like Home Depot. So that makes you wonder if that's a positive view going into earnings. Management has been winning more than they're losing these days, whereas before they were losing a lot more because they couldn't keep pace with Amazon. I would just say that this will be a great read on consumer spending. We're going to find out if the rich are still going down to Walmart and skipping Target. They've been doing that for the past year or more. Ever since Target blew up on earnings. They've been moving into Walmart. Maybe it was all related. Maybe the stealing and the all that wasn't the story, but it was literally a trade down. Inflation's moderating, so that might impact Walmart in that you don't have to go shopping for cheaper goods. But we are in a rising earnings cycle, so Walmart should benefit. So long story short, Walmart's earnings should come in fine. The trade down is very real. They still have room to run. The chart is positive. And again, they're a great rate of consumer spending. It should be like if they say the consumer's trading in to them still, that should continue to drive revenue. It's interesting that you say about translating the shopper into better revenue. I don't know if you remember, Facebook always had 2 billion people, but they couldn't translate it into revenue. Remember before Meta took off, maybe Walmart's in its Facebook phase where they're finally figuring. They can become more profitable with a lower income base of consumers and climb higher. I mean, they still sell a lot of crap, but I mean, TVs are cheap in there, for God's sake. I'm just like, stuff in there is just amazingly cheap in parts. Last part is grocery. It'll be a good read on how they're handling grocery. I haven't seen Albertson report. I think they report next month or so. But if they're dealing with if it inflate they'll have a great read on inflation. So if Walmart if they say inflation is tailing lower, it should be followed by the market because they have a their grocery is impacted greatly by inflation. And you can tell when they don't want to buy a good because they have large shelves with empty space on them. I'll go in there and you'll find like rows of Rice Krispies filling spots because they don't want to buy a good to fill that spot because it costs too much. If those, it'll be a great read going forward on inflation in general.
That's actually very interesting. So I remember they have an internal inflation index which is well renowned and it's quite accurate. So it'll be interesting to see what they talk about on the inflation front because they seem to be well ahead of the curve.
Yeah, definitely.
Another one of what a week is John Deere. I don't know if your car park kind of theory is going to work on this one unless you've been driving around the farmland. But John Deere is reporting pre-market on Friday. They also bumped their annual outlook earlier in the year in May, I believe. So, what are your thoughts on this one?
Personally, I like John Deere store. If I was a kid in a candy store, the John Deere store, you almost want to. I still think of this to this day. You want to jump on one of their tractors and play, like just sit there and drive. I mean, they're really cool stores, though. You don't see too many of them. And Tractor Supply are the big players around here. Anyway, Deere's chart stalled, and I wonder if this has to do with the fall in grain prices. So, as you probably know or don't, grain prices are a very key driver of Deere's earnings. If the farmers do not have money to spend on Deere equipment, it ultimately affects them. They have done a very good job of broadening out the base of their business, though. So they have these stores that attracts non-commercials. They got retail going in there, buying other stuff. I find it. I talked to somebody who actually bought Ford food for their horse from a Deere store, and it was the most random conversation I ever had because I don't own a horse and I didn't. Honestly, know what how horses ate. thought they ate hay, but whatever. This person was buying pellets and stuff. But it got me wondering. I'm like, all right, so how diverse? I remember years ago, Deere's problem was they were too focused on the farmer. And commodity prices from long periods of time would track lower because we had an economy that just typically had too much supply of product. Pandemic flipped that over, grain prices skyrocketed, but they've turned over this summer. Like corn prices and wheat tried to rally on the Russian news, but that didn't happen. So now, Deere, I think investors are looking at this like, ooh, all right, now corn is sinking, wheat is sinking, beans are sinking. What will the future demand look like? So John Deere stock to me feels like General Mills to some extent. Before General Mills' earnings story flipped, they were riding a profit storm. They had great revenue, and then all of a sudden they didn't because they couldn't. Their story ended. I think Deere's in the same boat. Everybody's really bullish on this name. I think it's like 90% of bloggers are bullish. It's like crazy number. Analysts are 11 and 6, so you get 11 buys versus 6 holds. So there's room to raise it. But I think the stock is at resistance, and I think the community, I think the world is a little bit worried about, or traders are a little worried about the fall in grain prices, and they have to answer that question: are they seeing moderation in that demand? Grains just don't look like they're in a good place, even with Russia's like sucking supply of wheat out of the markets. Wheat prices are still sinking. That argues that demand for the stuff is falling. If farmers aren't going to spend money, that's going to hurt the future outlook. So I would just say that the current numbers are probably pretty good. The chart looks fantastic on the earnings basis. I mean, we're looking at higher numbers over the last 3 years. If the outlook doesn't sandbag this positive picture, the stock will probably break out. But there is a, I think there's definitely a worry about the falling grain prices factoring into the equation. It might be too soon for them to see it, or they won't admit it, one or the other. So we'll see. But it's just the revenue and earnings look great. The chart stalled. I think it's all because of the corn markets, the wheat markets, the bean markets all moving lower.
Got it. And I'm looking at the chart now, and it does definitely look like it's hitting that resistance type of level around that band.
Like the third
So,
time too. So it's the third time at this level in the last 8, 10, 12 months.
yeah, it's definitely it's even kind of more full fifth time it's kind of hitting that level.
Oh,
So
yeah. So it's like a major. I didn't even look at this, but I wonder if corn prices roll over at the high, have rolled over at the highs every time. I didn't even think to look at that, but oh, actually, do I have a chart up? No, I don't. But anyway.
So on to the favorite part of the show, the three L's, like it, love it, leave it. And we're kind of staying on the earnings theme this week, as there's a few more names coming out. On holding, let's kick off with ONON. They are Tuesday pre-market.
So it's interesting that I've been looking at stats in the 3Ls lately. Post earnings, everybody's falling. So liking any stock hasn't been a good idea of late, but leaving them has been quite good. Onan, I like it. There we go. Broke out over 34, but has weakened with the markets of late. So people are selling. Maybe the store, the maybe the earnings post sell is reversing and people are getting ahead of it. As long as 34 holds, I can see it going higher.
And HRB, H&R Block, they are Tuesday after the close.
I like it. I climbed past 65 weeks. Got a really nice looking chart. Looks like to climb further.
EAT, Brinker International, they are Wednesday pre-market.
Very interesting read on the consumer if they're eating out, and I don't think they are as much. I would leave it. Fell through support of the 20 week. Looks like it wants to go to the bottom of the range.
JD.com. They are Wednesday pre-market.
So this one's always difficult. It seems to zag when you think it's going to zig. So that's the right way to say it. I don't know. But it'll be a great read on China's consumer. And we're trying to figure out where the consumer is. Right now, the market thinks the consumer is going to be weak. So I would leave it. Looks like China's weakening, as I just said. It'll give a, this will be a great one of those great stocks for a good read on where China consumer is.
Yeah, there's a lot of China news that we want to keep an eye on. TJX, they are Wednesday pre-market.
So speaking of the trade down to cheaper goods, well, TJX featured cheaper goods, and its stock price has been rocking and rolling. I like it. It's in breakout mode above 82. Not the best candle last week. I think that has to do with the broad markets more than anything, with the S&P trending lower. So there's probably some little in there might be some trepidation heading into the report, due to, again, fearful of what the consumer has done of late. But I like the chart.
And last one, there's also some news out the other day as well, but Tapestry, they are Thursday pre-market.
Ugly chart. I fell through major support, two supports with all the news. I forget what the news was, but it doesn't matter. I would leave it. Fell hard from 41, then moved through the 65-week, arguing it's going lower. It has a very large range below. I think it's a pandemic climb range, so they could be filling a pandemic range of sorts.
Brennan, love chatting to you. Thank you for spending the time with me. Doug's also on vacation in Australia, so he may or may not be back next week. But always love to catch up on the markets with you, and love to maintain the 3 L's. Thank you for your time, and good luck investing this week.
Hey, you too, Maddie. Have a great week.
You too. Thanks, buddy.